Good morning.
Good to see you all this morning. I wanted to just give a brief plug. You'll let me do that, won't you? A plug. Kelly Conway got into trouble for doing that this week, but hopefully this won't get me into trouble. Since you all have been through the Healing the Heart process now and have begun to experience, I think, some of the fruit that comes out of that, the Spirit, I think, last week, just some of the evidence of that. I mean, since when do Baptists have a unanimous vote for anything other than adjournment or to go out and eat somewhere? I mean, that's just about the only thing that will get unanimity. But you guys, as a body, I think got to experience one of the impacts of the solemn assembly that you had. And this is what I do. I was in a church, like I said, in Oil City, while you all were having that solemn assembly. I am scheduled to go out to several other churches, one in Manchester, one in Punxsutawney, where I will be helping these churches through a similar process. And what I need is people who have been through the process, who understand kind of the tension and the anxieties and fears and all the issues that a church has to deal with properly to get things right with Jesus and with one another, to hear His voice, to respond to what He's saying courageously and humbly. All of that requires a lot of prayer, and you had about 250 people praying for you as you did that. What I'd like to do is see if we can get 300 praying for the next church. And so if you, and all I ask, and I'll send out a notice to you, what I'm asking for you is your name and a clearly printed email address. If you try and handwrite this and or scrawl this, it will not work. I can tell you I've done it enough now. I know that I need clarity to be able to input those into my computer and send it out. I also have a check mark box there that you can check mark for notices that come from our headquarters down in Atlanta, Blessing Point's headquarters. And you'll be on the prayer list for them as well. But you don't have to check that if you don't want to be on that. But if you were willing to pray for me as I go out, I usually send a letter out right before I'm about to have either a retreat or a solemn assembly in a church and ask for people just to cover those churches in prayer. I also am pretty clear about how I want my prayer warriors to pray, and that is you can pray when you get the notice, but I also ask them to be very open to the Spirit of God, to His prompting, because there may be moments through a weekend when I'm leading a church through a review of their history to hear what Jesus is saying, where the Spirit of God will prompt people who are open to kind of His prompting to pray at a specific moment for a body that needs it. Now, again, the Spirit of God knows what's going on, but I get a lot of testimony back of how God moved individuals to pray at a certain time, and I know what was going on at that particular time and why the Spirit of God might be doing that. So it's a way I get to see, and you'll probably get to experience, the larger connections we experience within the body of Christ. And so it's kind of a wondrous thing. Anyway, the sign-up sheet is out where you, if you're a guest, you sign up with a little podium out there and on the bar out there. I'm not sure what you call it. What is it? Welcome Center. That's a much better name than a bar. So if you'd sign up for that, I would appreciate it, and I look forward to kind of staying connected with you. Again, one of the things that happens out of this, and it certainly happened here too, is I make a lot of friends as I go into churches and do this, even the ones that I'm only there for a couple weekends. Friendships grow, and people who just kind of feel a passion for the church and want to see kind of Christ glorified in His church, just friendships open up, and I've certainly felt that here, and I am very, very grateful for it. If you'll turn in your Bibles today to the book of Exodus, chapter 28. some of us remember our youth, preschool youth even, because of the nature of intergender relationships as a preschooler, probably to early adolescence, you know, teenage years, that intergender relationships were governed by the firm belief that if you touched a girl, if you're a boy, or you touched a boy, if you were a girl, you got what? Now, you need to know that that is a cross-cultural thing. Who knows how that got started? But it's like universal that a fear is created in the hearts of children of touching one another, because we know, and it's a fact, that if you touch somebody of the opposite sex, you are going to contract something. Now, no one has ever seen a cootie. Nor does anyone really know what they are. But it's a fact that if you touch somebody of the opposite sex, that touch taints you with cooties. Well, we live in the day when the fear of infection is a growing concern. And I notice out there on the in the Welcome Center is a big container of hand sanitizer. I wonder how many of you ladies have hand sanitizer in your purses. We carry it around. We just see it everywhere. Because, again, there's a fear, there is a concern that something we might touch, someone has gone before us and touched who had a cold or the flu or some other kind of disease or infection, and we will be tainted by touching it. And so we are constantly doing this now. And there is a concern that has become kind of, again, culture-wide, that something we touch is going to taint us. Well, the Bible teaches us actually something similar, that what we touch can be tainted. And it's interesting when a church has gone through the process you have gone through and held a solemn assembly, and you experience what takes place in a solemn assembly, which is different from kind of personal confession and cleansing that we receive, the experience of corporate cleansing, and where the body itself experiences a level of cleansing, and there are expectations that tend to flow out of that experience. We felt how perhaps exciting it was, how dramatic it was, how heartbreaking it was as your leaders confessed and led you in confession and repentance. But sometimes there's a misconception that having done that, out of that experience, we will be perfect. That perfection now is the expectation. But we humans have a problem in that everything we touch, we taint. Sin cooties, you can think of it that way. Sin cooties. It's like anything we touch, we taint. I experienced that this week as I was preparing this message. I was into it. I was kind of wrestling with the passage, and of course it's on this kind of topic, and I'm thinking about it really hard. My wife was sitting at the breakfast table and was reading the newspaper and started to laugh and says, "Let me read you something." And I turned around and I snapped at her. I said, "I'm in the midst of something here." She's like, "I'm sorry." And so I turned my heart back to this holy message that I just tainted. It's like anything we touch, we taint. Well, there's a wondrous couple verses. In fact, today I'm going to take you through a number of passages, so get your Bible leafing fingers ready as we look at a couple things that are, I think, pretty significant here. I want to look specifically at Exodus chapter 28, verses 29, and then verses 36 through 38. Verse 29 says this. It's about the ministry of the high priest. It says, "And Aaron shall carry the names of the sons of Israel in the breastplate of judgment over his heart when he enters the holy place, for a memorial before the Lord continually." And then you jump down to verse 36. "And you shall also make a plate of pure gold and engrave on it like the engravings of a seal, holy to the Lord. And you shall fasten it on a blue cord, and it shall be on the turban, and it shall be at the front of the turban. And it shall be on Aaron's forehead." And if you have a pen, you might want to underline the next phrase. "And Aaron shall take away the iniquity of the holy things which the sons of Israel consecrate with regard to all their holy gifts. And it shall always be on his forehead, that they may be accepted before the Lord." Before we look into this passage, let's turn our attention to him once more in prayer and just open our hearts up to what the Spirit of God has for us out of his word today. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for the opportunity to lift you up in praise and draw near to you in our hearts, through our singing, through our worship. You alone are worthy of our worship, and we have offered it to you today. And now, Lord, we know you have something for us in your word. And Lord, you know all of our journeys. You know where we are on the map. You know right what we're struggling with and the issues we deal with. Would you just take your word and minister to it to our hearts today, so that we are equipped to leave here and live the rest of the hours of the week in a proper relationship with a proper understanding of what we can do and what you do for us as your children. We ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we see here the ministry of the high priest, and it's an interesting ministry he has. And it connects with us because one of the things that we are told later on in the epistles, Peter tells us that all God's children now, all who believe in Jesus, have been inducted into, and if you didn't know this, this is interesting for you to begin to think about and explore, that we have been inducted into a royal priesthood. It's one of the great tenets of Baptist faith is that every believer is a priest. We have become priests. Now, we don't have the duties of the priests of the Old Testament because we have had a sacrifice offered that covers all other sacrifices. But the significance of being a priest is something that is not always well understood. The priest, and particularly the high priest, because of his role, stood between God and humans. It was what is called a mediatorial or mediator's role, where an individual stands between two parties that have issues and mediates between them. And in doing so, to do it properly, there are two directions that priest has to operate. He has to stand before God, and he ministers to God on the behalf of humans, the humans that he represents. But then he also turns to that body of people that he represents, and he presents God's interests to them so that they understand what God wants. And it's interesting how in our roles as human beings, we find ourselves in that mediatorial role all the time. All our authority relationships, I believe we are in that role, or should see ourselves in that role, as royal priests. That is, if I am a father, I stand before God on behalf of my wife and my children. And I represent them to God and represent God to them. If I'm a mother, I do it with my children, represent God, them to God, and God to them. If I am a child, if I'm an older sibling, I do it with my younger siblings. If I am a supervisor at work, I have a body of people under me, and I would take very seriously kind of doing it in that role. That is, that in all our human relationships, and of course when you come into church, it becomes a lot clearer, where I might have a Sunday school class of kids, and in a very real sense, I represent them before God. I go to God in prayer for them. I pray that God will teach them, will bless them, will work in their lives. But I then also am very clearly representing God to them in the teaching that I do. Deacons are in the same role. Pastors are in the same role. It's what being a priest, a royal priest, means. And so we've all been inducted into that. And it's pretty significant that we understand that twofold ministry, going to God to represent the people that we represent, to their interests before God, as well as represent God to them. So this mediatorial ministry, I think, is very, very important when it comes to sin cooties. That everything we touch, we taint. Because we have to understand now the significance of this ministry and why God would induct us into this ministry. And perhaps more significantly, the ministry that Jesus has in our midst all the time as our high priest. One of the things that he is doing that most of us do not realize that he is doing is described by this. Because we need that mediator representing us to God. Because we blow it all the time. Put your finger here, and I want you to turn to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. So almost to the end of the Bible here. John 2, verse 1, it says, "My little children, I am writing these things to you that you may not sin. If anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous." So here is Jesus performing for us that mediatorial role. If we've messed up, if we blow it, if we sin, we now have someone who comes between us and God to mediate for us. And we have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for those of the whole world. The reality is that Jesus now, whenever we mess up, whenever we blow it, whenever we defile the holy thing that we may be offering, we have an advocate who comes and represents our interests before a holy God. That's what Jesus is doing, especially when we sin. So it's not that he did something on the cross and Jesus doesn't do anything else for us. He is actively operating as our high priest. As I speak, he is doing it. That is what he is doing among us. In fact, the significance of that comes is that every one of this worship team up here this morning tainted their worship. Now, Debbie might not have, but everybody else did. Now, Debbie's shaking her head. She did too. They tainted their worship. And so did you. So did you. The heart that you brought had all sorts of stuff going on. And it is impossible for people in this world to offer something spectacularly holy without a taint. John tries to communicate this. Go back to chapter 1, verse 8. He says, if we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Now, I knew a woman when I was a pastor in Michigan who said to me, and this I'm telling the truth here. She says, Pastor, I haven't sinned in 7 years now. I said, oh, really? I said, well, then you should take my job, because I don't think I got out of bed this morning before I sinned. And she says, oh, she says, I haven't. She says, I have not sinned in 7 years. I said, are you saying you haven't been angry? She says, oh, well, Jesus got angry. I said, are you saying you haven't had an envious thought? Paul talked about that in Romans 7 and how that's taken care of. He's not bound by that stuff anymore. I said, are you saying you haven't lusted? She says, I was in a place where the demon of lust jumped off of somebody onto me, but it was their demon, it wasn't mine. If we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So all the leaders who humbled themselves 2 weeks ago, and repented and confessed, did not become perfect by doing that. Your new pastor, great guy, well chosen, Pastor Mike, is not perfect. He's going to taint every sermon he delivers to you. He's going to taint every decision, every leadership step that he makes, because that's all we can do. As humans, our touch taints. And that's why we need a high priest who is ministering to us at this moment to cleanse that taint away. Just think of all the ways that sin taints the holy things we offer. We've got distractions. So we come to worship God together as a church, and we're sitting here and we're thinking about the game this afternoon while we're worshiping. Or we're thinking about the pot roast in the oven. Or we're thinking about, you know, the cologne of the person sitting next to us. Our minds are, they can't focus completely. Or we've got pride. We think we can sing better than whoever's up here. Or preach better. You probably can. Teach better, you know, than he or she can. We self-promote. We exaggerate when we tell a story. We exaggerate to make ourselves look better than we actually were in the story. We've got laziness. We got, you know, people singing, oh, you know, I know that they have needs back there in children's ministry, but, I've done enough. We've got mean-spirited stuff. I'm not going to talk to her. We've got bitter stuff. I'm never, ever going to talk to her again. We've got envy. Boy, I wish I could drive the car that he does. I wish my kids were like their kids. I wish I could be the mother that she is or the father that he is. We taint everything, even the holy things we offer. Even in the midst of worship, lifting up our Lord and Savior, lifting up our God, who has done all that he's done for us, we taint it.
So we need our mediator to help us in what we offer. And our mediator is willing to do so. One of my very favorite passages in all the New Testament is when a leper, this happened early in Jesus' ministry, where a leper comes and falls on his face before Jesus and says, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." And Jesus said, and acted. It says he reached out and touched the leper. Touching a leper in that culture was a no-no because leprosy tainted you. But Jesus was unafraid of the taint. He reached out and touched him and said, "I am willing." Oh, hear that today. As you come and taint what you touch, what you offer, you have a Savior who is willing to touch you and take that taint on himself. "I am willing. Be cleansed." So flip back to Exodus and take one last look at this beautiful verse, verse 38. Exodus 28:38. Talking about the plaque, plate of pure gold that has "Holy to the Lord" written on it, fastened in the front to the turban. Moses says, "And it shall be on Aaron's forehead, and Aaron, as high priest, shall take away the iniquity of the holy things which the sons of Israel consecrate." See, their touch has tainted them. "And he will take away the iniquity of the holy things which the sons of Israel consecrate with regard to all their holy gifts, and it shall always be on his forehead, that they may be accepted before the Lord." So God wants to accept our gifts, and our touch is tainting every single one of them. But we have a high priest standing in between us, actively doing something to remove the taint of the holy things we offer so that they become acceptable to a holy God. And I don't know whether that inspires your love and adoration of Jesus, but it should. But it should. That he is doing that for you right now. Hebrews 7 says, "Therefore, he," Jesus, "is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them." Again, it's what he's doing all the time for us. He always lives to intercede for them. "Such a high priest meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens." So I can guarantee that your next pastor is going to taint every sermon. Your deacons are going to taint everything they do. What we all need to understand is that Jesus cleanses the cooties, the sin cooties, off of everything we offer and makes it acceptable. That is who we worship today. That is who is present every time his people gather and ministering to them in ways they don't even know or see to make what they offer acceptable to God. Let's bow together for prayer. Oh, Lord Jesus, we love you today. We thank you for what you do for us. Because, Lord, we know our hearts. We know how we mess up. We know how we wreck things that are wondrous and beautiful. Wreck relationships, wreck worship, wreck love, wreck all sorts of things. Lord, teach us how to lean hard into you when we come and gather in your name here. Teach us as we operate in our priestly roles how to represent the people that we care about well before you, interceding for them, ministering to them on your behalf. Teach us all these things and let us walk and follow our high priest and learn what he does for us and learn to do it for others. Lord, if there's someone here who has never received the cleansing that he offers, the one that saves the soul from death and judgment, that they might turn their hearts to him today and put their faith and trust in him, because he will take away all their sin and give them eternal life. Lord, if there's someone like that, draw them to yourself even now, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.